Hello and welcome to Legally Speaking with me, Tarun Nangia. In the second part of our episode with Mr. Mukul Rohatgi, I would like to ask him on his journey from a student at model school Barakhamba to government law college and eventually becoming the additional solicitor general and also the attorney general of India. In the second part, we cover his entire journey and know from him the kind of cases he's handled and his association, of course, his most famous association. They say there is a troika in Delhi of great friends. It's Arun Jaitley, who's currently the finance minister of India, Raian Karanjawala, who's also made a name for himself in the legal fraternity, and of course, Mr. Rohatgi. Welcome, Mr. Rohatgi, to our program.
Thank you.
And so there is this whole saying in Delhi that Mr. Jaitley, Mr. Raian Karanjawala, and you actually virtually grew together as lawyers. How true is that?
See, Mr. Karanjawala and I were together in the law college. That's how our friendship started.
In Bombay.
And Mr. Jaitley and I, we started knowing each other from the first year of our profession, which was 1978. Yes. And as luck would have it, his chamber in the High Court and my chamber in the High Court very close to each other. So we have been very close friends from that time, which is now nearly, what, 4 decades. And today he is holding very important ministries, so he's hard pressed for time. But we still manage to meet at least once a week for a meal or a coffee. And if not anything else, I land up at his house at about 6:30 a.m. in the morning,
yes,
so as to have a morning tea with him and walk for 20 minutes. So we have kept up our
There is one well-known anecdote in legal circles in Delhi, which we got to know, you may only confirm, that, you know, a best friend always stands by his best friend. And it is said that in the VP Singh government, when VP Singh decided that Mr. Arun Jaitley should be made the additional solicitor general, it is you who actually ran from pillar to post requested certain people that he should be made a senior counsel. Is this story true or we got it wrong?
No, I mean, it may be true, but it's not as big as a story as you have made out. It is true that Mr. VP Singh wanted to appoint Mr. Jaitley, and it was his desire and our desire that he should be designated as a senior counsel by the High Court. And you know, those days, not many people went about getting designations because it was not such a great thing in those days. And there were very few judges in the High Court then, maybe about a dozen. And the appointment was going to take place in a day or 24 hours or 36 hours. So had the application been moved in the normal course, it would have taken a couple of days. You had to have a full court meeting, all judges must sit together, papers must be complete and all that. And then, you know, the appointment would have come first and this would have come later. So I went and requested. It was a little embarrassing for Jaitley himself to go and request. So I went and requested, and I told the senior judges that this is going to be an honor, not only for him, but for our High Court. Not many people from our High Court,
Delhi High Court,
had gone and become law officers in the Supreme Court. And all the judges, I must say, readily agreed. So I asked them to do it by circulation, which means that the file goes to all the 12 judges and can be finished in an hour. Rather than calling a full court.
So you mean it was done in an hour?
It was done in maybe half a session, which is about 2 hours. And by the end of that day, about 4:30, the resignation had happened and a notification was issued in the evening. And the next day, Mr. Jaitley took over as Additional Solicitor General in the Supreme Court. And we got him a new gown,
yes,
because a junior lawyer's gown and a senior lawyer's gown are different. And that is how he started.
So these are some memorable instances?
Of course, very, very memorable.
And
I remember the time when I went to the judges at lunchtime and I requested them.
So you also got your chance to become Additional Solicitor General in 1999, much later. And you have, I think, told somewhere somebody that it gave you an insight on the way the government works, because till then, that point, you didn't have that insight. Could you share a few experiences?
Yeah, see,
about
you must understand, as a private lawyer, you don't really know how the government works, because the government has long procedures and set procedures, so you don't know how they work. And I have always been a private lawyer, so I got a chance to become an ASG in 1999. And I also wanted to shift out of the High Court by then.
Yes.
because I had been in the High Court for 20 years.
20 years.
From 78 to 98. It's 20 years.
Long years.
And, you know, I was kind of getting fed up with the same kind of work. So I wanted to shift out to the Supreme Court. This gave me an opportunity. So I took that opportunity. I did huge number of cases in those full 5 years that I did till the Vajpayee government lost power.
Yes.
And I really came to know what the bureaucracy is, what is the hierarchy.
You cherish that experience?
I mean, for the first time when I looked at those files with green notings,
yes,
which is called page 1N and 2N and yes, 3N, I was quite flummoxed.
It was
because, you know, the it's not people speaking to themselves, they are speaking through the file.
Yes.
So the file would often say, a senior secretary telling a subordinate who puts up, say, a particular note, he would say, please speak.
Yes.
That would be the note in the file. And then they would speak and then again work out. So it was just...
That, of course, helped you when we became aging.
No, it does help you. You know how the government... You have to also understand that, you know, you understand the hierarchy. The secretary, then there's the additional secretary, there's the special secretary, the joint secretary, there's the director. So how the file moves,
now,
how
I'll
it goes...
I'll take you back 3 decades ago. So I'll take you to more than that even. I'll take you back to 77, 78. Your father... was appointed a judge of the High Court in 1972. When you were a budding lawyer, did that
No,
help
I was not
you?
A budding lawyer. I was in college.
You were in college, 77. Yeah. So, 78, when you actually started, did it help you get cases that your father was a judge? Or
no,
was it somebody else? Or I mean, what?
No, not at all. See, my father became a judge in 72.
Yes.
I joined first year in Delhi University in 1972.
Okay.
I became a lawyer in 1978.
Yes.
Full 6 years had lapsed.
Yes.
So it was not immediately, you know, giving the baton to somebody.
Yes.
So there was a big gap. My father had a rented office, a small office in Chandni Chowk.
Okay.
Which he had given up.
Yes.
All the clients obviously would go to different lawyers because the case is ongoing. So when I started in 78, I had my dad's counsel.
Yes.
His advice. That of course was available to me, which was invaluable.
Yes.
And I had access to his library,
yes,
which was also invaluable. Yes. Those were days, please remember, there were hardly any photocopies, there was no computers, there was no WhatsApp, there was nothing. So you had to rely on physical books.
Yes.
So that's the advantage I had. And that's all.
But I want to know from you, you're the most sought after standing counsels in the country today. Who allowed you these first opportunities to actually stand as, who would you regard as your mentor, who helped
See,
you?
See, my mentor, undisputably, was late Chief Justice Sabharwal.
Chief Justice Sabharwal.
He was a flourishing lawyer in the Delhi High Court. He had a lot of work. His father was also a leading lawyer in the trial courts.
Yes.
And I joined him. That was my luck. And right from the first day, he encouraged me to go and appear in cases. And sometimes he would sit beside me and see that how I argue a case.
So you were given?
It gave me a huge amount of encouragement. And sometimes small cases, which he wouldn't want to do, he would pass on to me, which was hardly any money involved.
So he gave you that platform,
yes,
and
so
gave you that encouragement.
Undoubtedly, the entire encouragement and the start I had in life, yeah, was only because of him.
There's a small anecdote about you. You studied in Modern High School, a school that has given greats like Justice Madan Bhimrao Lokur, Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul, and of course Justice Sanjeev Khanna. They say the principal M.N. Kapoor had a strong influence on you. Is it true?
That is not only on me. I think Principal Kapoor had such an imposing personality that he had influence over hundreds of students spread over maybe 30 to 40 years. And the person that you are mentioning as judges, they were all a year above me or 2-3 years
so,
below me.
So they are
me.
Familiar, that is.
Obviously, we are all familiar.
Yes.
So, but that familiarity, I must tell you, makes no difference in court.
Yes.
That's important.
Then I go to one more point. See, your father was a gold medalist from the University of Delhi in the Faculty of Law. You did not succeed in getting admission to the University of Delhi, you had to go to Government Law College, Bombay, which itself has produced greats in law like Soli Sorabji. Of course, Raian Karanjawala is also a student from there. How did your worldview change when you landed up in Bombay?
See, I knew Bombay well because I was born in Bombay and my mother's family is from Bombay.
Yes.
And please remember, in those days, the Bombay High Court was the most premier high court.
Yes.
Out of all the high courts. It was virtually as important as the Supreme Court, being the commercial capital, and all the litigation was there. And it was really a boon in disguise that I landed up there. And I thoroughly enjoyed my tenure there. And I actually originally wanted to settle down in Bombay.
Because you were interested in commercial cases?
Because I was interested in commercial cases, and that was the commercial capital.
Yes.
But for some reason I didn't, and I came back thinking that the ultimate aim ought to be the Supreme Court. It is for that reason that I came back.
Yes.
And finally I did find my place in the Supreme Court for the last more than 25 years.
Yes. That's so now I'll take you back. There is an anecdote about you. You fought the very famous RNRL and Reliance Industries case, which was, anybody in the country knows this case now. And it is said that a neighbor was fighting a neighbor because on the plot of land on which Antilla, Mukesh Ambani is the chairman of Reliance Industries, residence now stands, you played when you were a kid because your grandparents used to stay in Dilkush, building which is more or less on the same plot as where the Antilla. Is it true? I don't know. But
this is only a coincidence that my grandparents used to live in a flat, in a building which is right across where the house of Mr. Ambani is.
Yes.
But obviously we were not neighbors in that sense, because I used to visit my grandparents, a couple of times a year, and Mr. Ambani was living elsewhere.
Yes.
It's just that now that he's built his house, it turns out
that's the only.
Yeah, yeah. So it's not a case of neighbors, etc.
Yes. So now, sir, I'll take you back to one of your first reported cases in the Supreme Court, which is a Shalimar cinema complex case. What precedent did it set, and what do you remember of this case?
See, I remember the client. He was Mr. Sabarwal's client.
Yes.
His cinema is near Rajdoot Hotel.
Yes.
On Mathura Road.
Yes.
His cinema was being sold in execution of a money decree which he couldn't pay.
Yes.
And Mr. Sabarwal had done the case before two benches in the High Court. We lost. The client didn't have money to go to the Supreme Court. So I was given the opportunity of doing it in the Supreme Court on my own. So I readily agreed. It was a great challenge. And as luck would have it, we succeeded with a thumping judgment, and his cinema was saved.
Yes.
And the client was so grateful. I haven't met him for the last 30 years now, but he was so grateful that he introduced me to a couple of wealthy clients from Bombay.
So you mean he didn't have money to pay, but he definitely paybacked in kind by introducing.
So he did pay back. And in fact, what he paid back in the form of getting good wealthy clients from Bombay, with whom I had a long lasting relationship in those days, that was much more in terms of money, if you calculate, than what he would have given as opposed to what the clients gave. So in fact, I am eternally grateful to that client for giving me the opportunity to argue that case in the Supreme Court, and which resulted in a lot of clients.
I have to cite two instances to you, sir, at this point. One is that it is said that you admire Samuel Johnson a lot and his sayings. Where does that, you quote saying said by him, where does that come from?
Just comes from a passion of reading.
Yes.
You know, I like to read. Unfortunately, I don't get much time to do.
Yes.
Read except the legal stuff. And I love to read history, geography.
Does that come from your father?
Yes, my father was a very academic minded person.
Yes.
And but he also knew commercial law. He knew how to resolve disputes.
Yes.
And his disposal of cases in the Delhi High Court during his tenure was one of the highest, which one could check even today.
Yes.
So the love for reading, buying good stationery, buying good pens, is really what I have imbibed.
But I now want to take you further. There is one more thing about you fighting pro bono cases, which you do without publicity. You know that's your service to law.
Yes.
And it's been said, Justice Mudgal made a point in last episode of Legally Speaking. They say the most successful lawyers who have a good practice are the ones who file good public interest litigations and who do very good pro bono cases, as opposed to busybodies whose only job is to file PILs. Would you agree with him?
I would agree with him. and I have often done pro bono cases, but the point is not to publicize
yes.
that you are doing a pro bono case or this case or that case.
Yes.
I mean, just a couple of days ago, in the Supreme Court, one of my first cases, which I did after relinquishing charge
yes.
As AG, was to appear for some young postal assistants.
You did?
Yeah, yeah. Those are not cases which I normally do.
Yes.
But they landed up in my office and said, no, we cannot pay your fee, we'll pay you some little fee. But I found that, those fellows were really suffering. So I said, okay, I'll do your case. And as luck would have it, we succeeded.
Yes.
So, it's like that. I've done a number of cases.
Now, I'll take you to your golden period. They say your golden period of your career in which, you were all over the press, inside, outside course, being discussed in, say, restaurants in the country, cinema halls, everywhere you were discussed. This was when you fought many high-profile clients. For many high-profile clients, Jayalalitha, you represented her. You represented Varun Gandhi, government of Gujarat. Of course, in many cases, it was everyday headlines for so many days. SR Group in the 2G spectrum yes. allocations issue. I know you have very strong views on that subject. Mm. And also Kanimoi of DMK. Could you share a few insights of these cases and your experience and also the judiciary stand on issues related to the executive? What all did you learn and could you reflect on that period?
See, I have appeared, as you said, not only for these people, but on a very wide spectrum of appearing for most of the corporates, most of the state governments, large amount of ministers, ex-ministers, people belonging to different political parties.
Yes.
It's not that I've appeared only for BJP ministers, I've appeared for all kinds of ministers, including Congress, SP, BSP, etc., etc. And I used to find it hugely satisfying that people of different political views also come to me. I must tell you, I am not a member of the BJP.
Yes.
People think that I am
yes.
because of my association with Mr. Jaitley or doing those.
But those are personal friendships.
Personal friendship.
That note, sir, we'll take a break before you continue and we'll be right back after the break and discuss more on the cases that Mr. Rohatgi fought, the names, the kind of names that I took and his experiences on that issue. Welcome back. Mr. Rohatgi, before the break, you were telling us that people would associate you to be a member of the BJP. That's not the case. Maybe because you're friends with Mr. Jaitley, that is why they allude.
And because I did these Gujarat riot cases and all that, and all those people are important people in the government
today.
But
the Gujarat riots cases were, I think, the most challenging cases of your career?
I think it was the most challenging case because the court, I must regretfully say, was very, very hostile.
Yes.
It started in about 2002.
Yes.
And I was the only lawyer defending the Gujarat government.
Yes, is that so?
In the Supreme Court. From 2002, at least for about 6, 7, 8 years, when the cases started, tapering down and became a little mellow, it was a very, very hard time. And I would face the flak every day in some court or the other in the Supreme Court.
But sir, we have heard this, and sorry to interrupt you at this point, but I would want to know from you that a lot of leading lawyers had given a pass to this case because of the kind of, you can say, they would know that it's not easy with, the kind of media hysteria and all that. So, sir, I mean, were those dark moments troublesome for you when you were, you were up against everything? I mean, does a lawyer face those moments? Because
lawyers face those moments. And, you have to understand, if you do a very difficult or an embarrassing case on one day,
yes.
one day is fine. You'll bear it 1 day, 2 days, 5 days.
Yes.
But I had to bear the brunt of it for a number of years.
Yes.
And with not much assistance from any other lawyer of good repute or standing.
You yourself alone.
So it was me and some junior lawyers and the officers, etc. And it went from case to case, whether it was my Best Bakery case or whether it was Godhra case or this case or that case. But I'm glad that I went through it because it was something like a trial by fire.
Yes.
So I am happy that I got that opportunity. And if you get that opportunity and you are able to come out in a reasonably good form, then obviously your stature as a lawyer also rises, and yes, then you are known
but
to
you,
the public.
But you do agree that you were under pressure because of the kind of work that it brought upon you in terms of the kind of hostilities and everything.
It was a hostile court.
Yes.
And that pressure really helps in making you a good or a strong lawyer.
Okay, that's a very fine point. If you reflect on your journey from, say, 1978 till today, what kind of an experience has it been in, say, about two or three lines? I mean, what kind of experience has it been?
It's been a long and an arduous journey. But it has been very rewarding. I'm grateful to all who have given me an opportunity to appear for them, whether it's private clients, whether it's government, whether it's public sectors, whether it's state governments. But one thing every lawyer must understand, there is no shortcut to success. You work hard, but you have to work hard all your life. It's not that today I can sit back and say that I'll do some cases tomorrow without really looking at them or without really reading them. Every day is a constant struggle, and that's
the only
way.
So you still go through the grind every day?
Every day I go through the grind. I start my office at 8:45 in the morning.
8:45 in the morning every day?
Yes, and I don't end by before 8:30.
So Mr. Rohatgi works 13 hours every day even today?
And I have always worked on Saturday and Sunday, though for limited periods.
Okay.
I have never taken a holiday on full Saturday or Sunday, but it's not, but I'm
so complaining. That is the cost of being Mr.
Yes,
Rohatgi.
But that's not a complaint. You have to do that.
Yes.
If you say you don't want to do that, then well, you will remain in a particular
but
level.
Talking about you, your sister Madhulika, if I'm not wrong, she made a point that Mr. Rohatgi, if you see in office, he'll be very calm, but he's like a duck who's furiously roaring underneath, while on courts he's different, but when he's in office, he's working, but you don't know. So would you agree with that kind of an observation?
Maybe,
by that?
See, she's my older sister, and maybe I think her perception is probably correct.
The Chief Justice of India, he made a statement that on the principle of reciprocity, foreign law firms should be allowed in India. How do you view his statement? Because he made it at a public function.
I think probably the view is correct.
Yes.
We cannot live in isolation.
Yes.
The world is looking at us.
Yes.
We are looking at the world. But reciprocity is important.
Yes.
If I can set up practice in London.
Yes.
A London lawyer should be able to set up practice here.
Yes.
And a lot of lawyers feel that it will take away their work and their bread and butter.
Yes.
But that's not correct.
Okay.
I mean, can you perceive that a British lawyer coming to India and appearing in Tisadari or the High
Very
Court
difficult.
And arguing a case relating to the Delhi Rent Act, it is impossible.
Yes.
So basically, it will be setting up offices
yes.
to do consultancy and a solicitor's work.
So, okay.
So what's wrong with it? Even that will bring money and business to this
yes.
country.
I would want to ask you, when Prime Minister Narendra Modi has often said that why India can't become a center of arbitration for the whole world, when you see that the SAIC, Indians go and, you know, do arbitration in Singapore, where Indian arbitrators don't get that kind of parity there. I don't know if I'm wrong on that point. Or even in London. So, you know, you'll have lawyers going to Blackstone and seeking membership there. Do you think India can emerge as a center for arbitration in the coming 8-10 years? Or the dream or the kind of statement that the Prime Minister made can be realized?
It can certainly be done. Because they are all homegrown arbitrations.
Yes.
This is a huge country with a huge population and huge number of disputes.
Yes.
So we have huge number of cases. If you have proper setups here and good arbitrators, why should we go and spend costly foreign exchange in Singapore or London or Paris? I don't understand why. And please mark my words, I have little experience of arbitration. I don't do too many. But I have often found that there is a bias in international arbitrations between the whites and the non-whites.
That's a very important...
It's as simple as that, but I've seen it.
Okay. Thank you. On that note, we end today's episode of Legally Speaking. Sir, thank you so much for sharing your time with us and sharing all these anecdotes. We'll cherish and looking forward for you to join us.
You have done your homework well in finding out where I lived and who's my sister.
Thank you so much. Thanks.